this was given to the Gujarat to the BJP, and BJP in turn allotted it to her, or this was being used by her on February 28. It could have been available to you in the form of, say, her visiting card or her letterhead, or it could have been some witnesses saying, yes, this is the number I used to call her on. This was a mobile phone that was being used by her, right? So if the SIT had produced witnesses or evidence of this nature during the trial, then that link also would have been established. But they deliberately did not establish that link. So this CDR evidence was out of the window, but there was already so much evidence, you know, all those direct witnesses, the eyewitnesses and all that. So on that basis, and there was also that Tahelka's sting operation, which was which received a very favorable mention in this judgment. It's something which is a feather in the cap of the media, that we played a role in upholding the rule of law in this very historic case, right? Which led to the first ever conviction of a high-level politician, of somebody who was a minister in the government, who, when at the time of her arrest, at the time when she was apprehending arrest, she went underground. She was underground for about a month or so, and was trying to get anticipatory bail. And it was only after her bail application was rejected by the High Court did she resurface and then surrender. During that entire period, the police, the Gujarat Chief Minister, were all feigned ignorance about her whereabouts. So this is a kind of farcical drama that we witnessed not so long ago. Ultimately, it resulted in this conviction of Maya Kodnani. But what would have been as important, and politically it would have been even more damaging, was the conviction of the police officer on the spot, Mysurewala. If he had been convicted on the basis of that CDR evidence, or if Maya Kodnani herself could have been convicted on the CDR evidence as well, then it would have been absolutely explosive, because that same CDR shows that these rioters were contemporaneously, during the violence, before the violence, after the violence, very much in contact with a whole lot of police officers, politicians, leaders of Sangh Parivar, VHP, all these rioters, and not to forget the CMO, right? So this was an explosive piece of evidence which the SIT went out of its way to downplay, render it ineffective during the trial. So these are the wheels within wheels. These are the insidious tricks that the SIT played, right? Even though they had a success in that case, a success which they could not help because it was all out in the open, right? And yet, this is the nature of the investigation. And when it came to the investigation into Zakir Jafri's complaint, there were far more such instances of contradictions between the evidence that they had and the conclusions that they were giving, the findings that they gave. There's such a mismatch. And some of that mismatch, they could not hide in that SIT report. So I took advantage of that. We don't know what else they suppressed, but I took full advantage while I was doing my book. I took advantage of whatever survived in that SIT report. Like this bit about this 5-hour gap. From where did I come up with this 5-hour gap discovery? It is there in that report itself. It's just that they did not notice it because they were focused on claiming that whatever he could have done on February 28th, the crucial day on which the post-Godhra violence erupted, he did. But look at the fine print, look at the details of what they had themselves said in the SIT report, that completely belies that claim. So that's how it went on.
Nanavati, who while he was appointed by the NDA, behaved in a particular manner, and while he is appointed by the Gujarat government, he behaved in a particular manner. Actually, it's not much difference, he faced the Piper's Neptune, actually. So why is it that this is happening? Adwani has said of journalists that when asked to bend, they talk. Is it true of, of generally true of people in positions of authority?
See, when it comes to positions of authority in the executive, we are quite combative and irreverent. But somehow when it comes to the judiciary, because of the legal trappings, because of their contempt powers, or because it's also technical, we tend to give them too much leeway. We are far too reverential for the good of our democracy. They get away with all sorts of very dubious decisions. And what you said about the conduct of these institutions being determined by individuals is absolutely true. Even in this Gujarat 2002 context, as I brought out in my book, when this bench was being headed by Justice Pasayat, you had a series of very path-breaking orders which were in favor of ensuring the rule of law in the context of 2002. He is the one who decided that the matter should be that these 9 cases should be referred to the SIT. In retrospect, one wishes that the composition of the SIT had been better, or maybe instead of SIT, he should probably have given it to the CBI. Had the Supreme Court taken this decision promptly on what is to be done with the other cases, instead of sitting on it, there was a needlessly prolonged stay on these cases, as a result of which, that by the time they came to apply this matter, their mind to this matter, there was a change in regime at the center in 2004. So then it became a little sensitive for them to refer these cases to an established entity like CBI. So because if they had referred it to CBI, then it would have opened up the possibility of the Congress-led government using these Gujarat cases to do politics.